We're going to talk about some of the issues that you might be having in the classroom with Caribbean dialects. Okay? I'd like to ask you, what was your first encounter with Caribbean dialects? Was it just in the classroom or only in the classroom?
It was in the like pop culture.
I think you have been peeking into what I've been doing.
Amon, like an In Living Color back in the day, right? The Wayans brothers. Am I cheating? Did I give it away?
You are, because I have something here for you. I think you've been peeking into what I'm doing.
I swear, I'm not.
Maybe this was really, come on in, your first encounter with Caribbean dialects. Can you hear it?
I'll try a little bit.
I'll sing along.
Yeah. Are we Beetlejuice?
Yeah. Work all night and a drink of rum. Stop banana till the morning come. Come, Mr. Tallyman, tally me banana. Come, Mr. Tallyman, tally me banana.
Most of you, you're familiar with that type of the Caribbean dialect. That actually, he's actually Carabella Fonte. He is his parents are Jamaican, but he was born here, and he kind of made Jamaica put Jamaica on the tourist scene back in the day. So some of you perhaps have encountered the Caribbean dialect this way, or maybe you might be more familiar with this type of Caribbean dialect. This is what you probably have heard.
Half a book and half a pencil, you gone to school. Bolo slush and suck, your belly must pull. Coconut brush and red rope dye, floor half a shine. Pick your own a tambourine switch, keep you in line. Use and reuse tea bag, take part water, bus gas. Fall on a bucket, chop off head with cutlass. Coconut bow for cricket bat, make bats for your ball. Walk with shoes in your hand, in time rain start to fall. Fry up overnight dumpling, tambourine ledge your teeth. Condensed milk and bread, what a sinking sweet. Flour carp hole in a pot, blue soap patch wash pan. With kim teeth keep a heart bun, we name Jamaican.
Okay, so how many understood what she was saying? Did you understand more of what Arabella Fonte was saying, right?
Yes.
Okay, we're more familiar with that. And so what you will hear as you encounter Caribbean people is a variety of dialects and accents. Arabella Fontes was a bit more sanitized, cleaner version of the Caribbean dialect, whereas the young lady that you listened to spoke what we call the raw Caribbean dialect. So what you find is, within the Caribbean, you'll find a variety of dialects. You'll find a variety of accents. What is interesting about Caribbean dialects, and I'm going to focus more so on Jamaica, because that's what I'm familiar with. But within the Caribbean, we have as much variety of dialects as we do the islands. So what you'll find is, if you're from Trinidad or from Barbados, St. Lucia, you will find that we speak pretty much the same language. However, there's a variation in the accent. So we do understand each other, but the accent will vary. And so a lot of times people will hear someone speaking and immediately think they're Jamaican, but not necessarily so. However, within the Caribbean, we understand each other. Now, the Caribbean dialects actually developed from contact, just as with any dialect, develops from contact between the English conquerors and Africans, and specifically West Africans. And this is where a lot of our dialect and or expressions come from in the Caribbean, from West Africa. One interesting thing about the dialect, especially the Jamaican dialect, is that it is 90% English words. It doesn't sound that way, right? When you listen to it, it doesn't sound that way, and it's only 10% what they call the tree language from Ghana, which is mostly the words that we use are words that you cannot really find an English word for. But the majority of the dialect is English. The reason we find it so challenging to understand the speakers is that, number one, they speak very quickly, right? And number two, there's such a variety of accent. So you hear a Jamaican, and then a Jamaican in Jamaica has a variety of accents, depending on where you're from. But they're really saying the same thing. We're going to look at that in a moment. Now, as I mentioned, a lot of our words are actually English words, but we have certain adaptations from West African language where the grammar is what takes its cue from the West African languages, particularly the tree language. Number one, the absence of the subject-verb agreement, and I'm sure those of us who are English teachers see that, where instead of saying John walks, the writer will say, or speaker will say, John walk. So the subject verb does not, you know, seem to agree. And this is a legacy from the West African influence. Then you have the zero copula, where you have the verb that links the subject and the predicate is missing. So instead of saying I am sick, you'll say sick or me missing. So there's no I am or is. There's no is. There's no verb there. There's also use of when you're pluralizing, instead of saying adding an S or an ES to the end, you add them. Now them is also another variation from or adaptation from West African languages, because instead of using the TH, we substitute the D. So them is actually them, okay? And so what you find is, if I'm going to talk about the books, instead of saying the books, I will say the books, the book them, and that indicates plural. And again, that comes from West African influence, okay? Then we also have the confusion of the active passive voice. And this again, you will see in your English classes. When I was working here years ago as a tutor, this is one of the things that I found a lot of students had difficulty with. We're going to talk about some of the reasons, the possible reasons for these, apart from the fact that a lot of it is adapted from, you know, West African languages. For example, there's a confusion of the active passive voice. So if someone wants to tell you that the food that was being sold is finished, will say to you, the food sell off. All the food is gone. But it could also be something that happened yesterday or a week ago. So it doesn't have to mean that it's something that's happening right now. So that's one of the interesting things that we also inherited from the African influence. Another one is where you make a statement that can be a question or a statement based on the tone of voice. So for example, someone will say to you, it can eat. That's a very simple phrase, right? But it can have two meanings, depending, more than one meaning, depending on how you place the accent. So if I say to you, it can eat, then that means I'm asking you, can it be eaten? But if I say, it can eat, then that means it has the ability to eat. Interesting, right? Are you following? I hope.
Could that also be the answer to the question? The question, can it be eaten?
Could it be
the answer that yes, it can be eaten?
So if I say it can eat,
or I can,
then
I
you
eat?
Can respond, it can eat. Right? So it could also be the answer to that same question. So depending on the tone of voice you use, it could mean one thing or the other. Okay. Another adaptation is the use of the B sound instead of V. So for example, vex, the word vex will become vex. The word heavy becomes heavy. We have a folk song in Jamaica that says, woman a heavy load when Saturday morning comes. So woman is a heavy, the man is singing that the woman is a heavy load when Saturday morning comes, because now he has to take money out of his pocket to send, you know, give her to go to the market, or, you know, go shopping. So she's a heavy load. So this is again an inheritance from West Africa, the West African languages, where they also use the same type of representation for words. There's also the absence of the TH sound, which I mentioned before. So everything now has a D sound. And so the becomes D, okay? The book, the teacher, so it's not the teacher. They and those and these no longer have the TH sound. It now has a D sound. And one that is very common also is a dropping of the H. So for example, instead of saying the word three, I have three pencils, I have tree pencils. So that again is an inheritance from West Africa. Now, the dialect was originally spoken by the poorer people, because again, at that time when we the dialects began in the Caribbean, this was when we were meeting with Europeans who we had to communicate with. And so the dialects came about that way. And so a lot of the people who spoke were just poor, the poorer class. And so after a while, even as we evolved as a people, the dialect became a sign of being lower class, and so a lot of people did not allow their children to speak it. Upper class did not allow their children to speak the language, the dialect, in their home. So it became kind of a guttural sound that was only spoken by poor people. The good thing is that every Jamaican understands the dialect. So whatever class you are, see, Jamaica, the Caribbean, I should say, is more structured on a class status. So if you are of upper class, you could be dark skinned, but you are upper class. You could be light skinned and lower class. So the class structure, more than your race, is what kind of represents most of the Caribbean. Now, what happened was that after a while, as the nations evolved and got their independence, and people started wanting to express themselves as individuals, as nations. And so what we found was that as time went on, the dialects became more and more a common way, a popular way of speaking, even as an upper class person. So what you will find is, based on where you are, if you're upper class and you live, you know, in a nice area, you could be saying the same thing as someone who is rural or downtown or ghetto, but because of the accent you place on your words, then it's going to be a little bit different. So for example, if someone is saying, my dear, I don't know what he's going to do. This is the English version, right? So an upper class uptown woman would say the same thing, but she's incorporating some of the dialect with her English words. So she will say, Meneer, I don't know what you're going to do. So she's speaking properly, but at the same time, she's using little bits and pieces of the dialect. Then you have someone who is downtown who will say, you want to say, Meneer, what are you talking about now? And so that's a different accent. It's more guttural. And then you have a rural person might say, why? We don't know what he might do. So they're saying the same thing, but as it goes down, you notice that there's more and more of the dialect incorporated. So it still is a sign of being, you know, it's associated with being lower class. However, you can nice it up, right? Make it, add some more English words to make it sound as if you're speaking English, but you're also speaking the dialect. Okay, now somewhere in the 1970s, 1980s, Jamaicans and all across the Caribbean, we had poets, musicians, and other artists who are saying, we need to stand up and stop speaking the Queen's English, because it's a slave language. It's the language of the masa. It's too European. We need to find our own identity. So they started advocating, and that's when people like Bob Marley became popular, right? Peter Tosh. We had Louise Bennett, who is a premier poet in Jamaica. She really started advocating for us, for the Caribbeanites, to speak their dialect and to make it into a language. And so more and more, it start, you know, you would hear the dialect being spoken less, I mean, more and more on the radio, television, it was now in the newspaper. So there was a kind of revolution then with the dialect. When I went to school, under a little bit more under the English system. So in school, we had English teachers, teachers from England, and teachers from the US. And so we learned the grammar, the structure. We learned the Queen's or the King's English. And so that was how we spoke, and that was how we wrote. But things started changing in the 70s and in the 80s. And this was greatly influenced by the Rastafarian movement. We know what the Rastafarians are, right? That religion that they wear dreadlocks. Now it's become more of a fashion statement, but it really is a religion that had a huge influence on the whole Caribbean in terms of how people approach language. And so the Rastafarian, they decided that it was time enough for the Caribbeanites to find their identity and speak their own language. So they kind of developed what was like a sub-dialect, which is a dread talk. So for example, you've heard the expression Irie. They started a whole sub-dialect where Irie meant everything was all right. So they were changing a lot of the English words that we use. So if you say Jamaica Irie, that means Jamaica is all right. It's nice. And so a lot of the words that people started using and which became popular in a lot of songs was because of this dread talk, which was changing the way people spoke. So English was no longer so much emphasized as it was when, I mean, that wasn't so long ago, but when I was a youngster going to school, English was what you spoke and wrote and read. But now things are changing. Also, what was happening is that as more and more native speakers of the dialect began going to college and becoming teachers, and they were now appearing in the classrooms and kind of replacing those old teachers who are English and American, because a lot of American teachers would come to the schools as part of, I think it was Peace Corps, they came, they gave us a year or two, and then they went back. So now, as they trained more and more native speakers of the dialect, and they started appearing in the classrooms as teachers, so now communication was a little bit different. And so the emphasis was no longer so much on speaking and writing and reading English. And so there was a change. The literature that we were now using was more Caribbean-based. We still learned Shakespeare, and those guys, but they were incorporating more and more of Caribbean literature. So V.S. Naipaul was one of those that we did a lot of his work. He won the Nobel Prize one year, I think it was 2000 or 2001. He's a Trinidadian writer. So now we started using more and more Caribbean literature within the classrooms. We used to have what we call the GCE exams, which was England-based. It was General Certificate of Education exams. And this was replaced by the Caribbean Examination Council exams, which was more Caribbean-based. And so everything was now, what was now different. And because of this, we find that a lot of the students, I should back up a little bit. With these poets and musicians and writers advocating for that nation language, or speaking, writing and reading the way that we speak, we found that there are a lot of changes in terms of students were now allowed to kind of write the way they spoke. And this is probably one of the issues that we find in the English classroom. where students now would be able to write, they're writing an essay, but it would allow them to also, if they couldn't remember the word or phrasing in English, they were allowed to substitute what they were familiar with. And because they had Caribbean or Jamaican teachers who were familiar with the dialect, then it was no problem. But the issue was it wasn't preparing them for living outside of the Caribbean. Now I'd like to ask you now, what issues, if any, do you encounter? So I've been speaking, but I'm speaking from my perspective. What are some of the issues that you as teachers encounter with essay writing or just in general in the classroom with the dialect?
Well, just all the things, the stuff you highlighted is like the grammatical things.
Mm-hmm.
The subject verb agreement, especially the using an object pronoun like me as the subject of a sentence and things like that. But given the examples that you showed,
mm-hmm.
I think a lot of our students are doing better than they could be doing. I don't know.
Yeah.
In other words, I feel like they've managed to overcome quite a bit, potentially.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I guess it depends on where they came from within
right. The
strata of Jamaican society or whatever. But, you know, I'm definitely not seeing in a developmental basic writing class that bottom line on the, you know, we had the three things
right. Going
there. I'm definitely not seeing that.
Okay.
I'm seeing the top two, maybe, or somewhere between the top two.
Okay.
So, I don't know, I guess it says something about the ability of our students to adapt.
Right. Right.
Even though a lot of these little things linger, like the subject verb agreement and,
right. And
the.
That probably is like one of the biggest ones, the subject verb agreement.
I find that's the hardest, maybe the biggest challenge, is because if you don't hear it as agreement,
right.
I mean, the only reason we know it's agreement is because we've learned it that way.
Right.
So we know when something's not agreeing because it sounds wrong to us.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
But for somebody who. It sounds wrong to them to put the S there when
right. They're
young, and the example you showed. It's totally relearning their inner voice.
Right.
But the other thing about subject-verb agreement, you say that it's influenced by the Ghana language, but it may very well be influenced by that, but it's also a complete anomaly even in English. I mean, English used to be highly inflected so that there was subject-verb agreement with
right. All
subjects
right. Saying
different verbs. The way it is in Spanish and German and lots of other languages today, but then as the language changed, it dropped all the endings except that one. So the reason that's so hard for our students is it's totally bonkers. I mean, it's not logical that we should have held on to the S when we didn't hold on to the other endings, the TH.
It does appear in African American English too.
It appears everywhere.
Where they say, you know, like, you know,
he doesn't.
Right. It's also
in country people everywhere
right.
Appalachia,
exactly.
White people
exactly.
of all color skins, all backgrounds, all cultural backgrounds,
right.
intelligently deduce that there doesn't need to be an ending on the end of a verb in English.
Right.
That's
right.
a very smart way of understanding the language. So
for
us to be insisting on that S, I think all students need to be sympathized with about that.
Exactly.
And ultimately, I suspect in 100 years it'll be gone.
Yeah.
And ultimately, the English teachers need to be sympathized with because we have to propagate all this.
Yeah, this is part of why I'm talking about this, because I realize that sometimes teachers don't see it that way. You know, wherein students are penalized all the time because they leave off the S or, you know, and because it's part of their culture maybe, the part of their everyday speech, it's not easy to simply switch. For example, with having students who speak Spanish as a primary language, sometimes I'm reading their essays, I know what they're talking about, but if I should sit there and correct every error they make, I would have red marks all over and it wouldn't make sense. I would have to just rewrite the paper for them. So sometimes I overlook some of that because it's just a part of the way they speak, part of their language. And sometimes it's not as easy to translate from where their mind is to put it on paper.
You know, I noticed my Caribbean students when they speak to me, they're using proper English.
Right.
When they speak to each other, no. But from what you're saying, is that going to get with time to the point that they can't speak the English, you know, that we're looking for in America? Or is there some backlash in Jamaica because it's limiting people from leaving that area?
Right. That is something that they had, I think it was in 2000, they had a proposal for an educational reform, which was trying to tell students, just write. It doesn't matter if you're writing English, just express yourself. And that, there has been an issue with that because it's not preparing students who are migrating. Because, you know, like Caribbeanites are, you know, part of the largest migrant population coming to the US. And so a lot of them come here unprepared. Yes.
That's the question I was gonna ask, is if students that are coming from Jamaica view English in the States, do they know that they're gonna be getting into a situation where it's borderline ESL? Because I work with immigrant students from a bunch of different countries, and it's always easier with students. I teach English as a second language. It's easier with the students that are have a Spanish background or from Patois background. Because you're like, all right, let's try to use English in the classroom and correct them. But students that have had from Jamaica, it's harder because it's not a different language.
Exactly,
English,
and that
so
was one of my
like,
questions too.
But that's just, I've only had limited experience with Jamaican in the classroom. So I don't know in general if when they're coming here they're realizing that, oh, I need to learn another language or how it's spoken differently there.
Yeah. You know, it's interesting that you asked that question because one of the issues that I have as a teacher in Jamaica, I taught high school in Jamaica before I came to the US, and one of the things that I found, okay, this is a scenario. Students will be, I had classes where there were students in my class who did not have their parents around. Parents had migrated and left them behind with the grandma or the auntie or sometimes just by themselves. And so they were waiting for their parents to sponsor them because you know that you have to get sponsored by someone to come here. And so a lot of them were waiting and they waited and they waited for years. Once they know their parents have filed the paperwork, a lot of them stop learning. I remember I had a student, I'll never forget Garnett. He came to school with one notebook rolled up in his back pocket. And all day long, Garnett would walk around smiling and always saying, he's coming to America, he's coming to America. And he just stopped learning. And that is a scenario that occurs over and over again. A lot of students, they have the idea that America is this land of, you know, gold and his streets paved with gold, they don't have to go to school or work. It's just, I don't know what it is that makes them think that way. And so they think, I think probably because when the parents are always sending stuff to them, it looks wonderful. That, you know, they're shipping the barrels down for the kids with nice stuff and they get all this nice stuff. They don't know how hard you have to work for it. So they have in their minds this golden place that they're coming to, and a lot of them stop learning. And so when they come to the US and try to get back into things, it's too late. They've missed a couple of years of high school. And so those are probably some of the students that we're getting. Because I worked in the learning center, the writing center some years ago, and I saw some of those students. They did not have any basis to come to college. They had stopped learning. So when they come here, they're unprepared for the fact that they have to start all over again pretty much. So we probably get some of those in ESL, or not ESL, because it's not really a language, but we have issues with some of them. Okay, any other comments? Yes.
This is a comment or story that's kind of related aside, but I was interested to hear you talk about in the 70s, how there was this push for a national language and the rejection of the King and Queen's English. And in my background as a museum educator, I once worked on the Finding a Place, Maintaining Ties West Indian exhibition at the Connecticut Historical Society. And the basis of that exhibition was 38 oral histories of
many of the founding members of what is now the West Indian, largely Jamaican community here in Hartford. And I remember one person in particular, Mr. Elliott, who was very upset with us because when we did the final version of his oral history, we left it in his own language. And Mr. Elliott's in his 80s now, and he was really upset with us. Mm-hmm. And it was interesting because as museum folks, we felt like, you know, we were doing them a service and allowing them to maintain their authenticity. Mm-hmm. And he was so angry that we didn't clean up the language. And I thought that was just really interesting, mm-hmm. just from a generational standpoint.
Exactly, that's what it is.
Yeah.
Because in the early days, it was, again, as I said, looked at as, you know, poor people's language, slave talk. And so a lot of that older generation would not embrace it. In fact, when Louise Bennett, who is now thought of as being, you know, one of our icons in terms of trying to preserve the dialects, when she started publishing her poetry in the Jamaican dialect in the 1940s, people were in an uproar. They didn't want that. But now, I find even in school, I did substitute teaching in Windsor, and the students were, everyone wanted to be Jamaican, and they were speaking the dialect. You know, and they're telling me, Miss, can you speak the Jamaican? I said, yeah, man, and they just laughed, you know, and they all tried to speak it. So it's interesting that now things have changed. They're now embracing it, but it's creating an issue in some of the schools where students come here and they're not prepared. One of the things that I looked into was some of the possible reasons that might answer your question. I'm sorry, your name is?
Joan.
Joan, yes, Joan. Okay, in the Caribbean, and I think it's still being done that way because I was speaking with my sister recently and she mentioned it to me. When we do reading comprehension, you read a passage and you find the answer in the passage. You don't form any opinion, which I find a lot of what we do here is forming an opinion and inferring meaning. It took me a long while to understand what is meant by inferring meaning, right? So when we read a passage, we do reading comprehension, but it's not the way that it's done here. So I think that probably might be one of the reasons why when, you know, you give assignments and you ask someone to infer meaning, they might have a difficult time because that's not how we learn it. We find the answer, you answer the question, you get 100%, but you have not been asked to form an opinion or to infer any kind of meaning. And of course, there's been that shift where there's no longer that emphasis on learning English, the Queen's English or the King's English. And so, you know, we're learning how to kind of switch back and forth between writing Jamaican or a Caribbean dialect and English. Okay, am I running over time or under time?
There's no clock in this room. That means
Nancy has to leave early.
Yes, she did say that.
I think it's 10 after.
It's now 10 after? Okay, so I have a few minutes. Okay, and as I mentioned before, you know, as more and more dialect-speaking teachers enter the classroom, because when I grew up, my teachers were mostly white from England, and we had some Americans. Most of the Americans taught art. They were like free spirits, you know, who came, and I remember I had a teacher, Miss Schnitzer. She used to ride a bike, and I was like so mesmerized by her because, you know, here's a woman riding a bike. It was never done, you know. And here was an American woman, and she was just marching along, you know. But this is how I grew up, and so we learned, I know, that structure. So when you talk to someone from the Caribbean, they will tell you that we speak English, and they will say that they learn English, and a lot of them will get upset if you say they're not speaking proper English. But I think what they're not realizing is that yes, we do learn it, but when you come here, it's a whole different ball game. When I started, I'm a past student of Capital, and when I came to do my placement test, I didn't do very well on the English because, I mean, I passed, I went to 101, you know, I did enough to get through, But I had taught English in Jamaica, you know, I taught for years. And when I did my placement testing, I had an issue because there were some of the sentence structures that I had learned differently. So for example, we had learned that when you're doing listing of three or more objects, you put a comma after the first two, and then the last one, you don't need a comma before the and. And so when I got that question on my my placement testing, it said which one is correct. I chose the one that I thought was correct, but I got it wrong. And I went to the guy, you know, and I said, I went to the guy who was administering the placement, and I said, this is not right. I know I got it right. And so I think that's part of what, you know, in a translation, maybe other students from, you know, European countries might have that issue also, where the way you learn English is a little bit different. The spelling, you know, neighbor and neighbor, color and color. So things like those, I think, you know. But of course, we're here. And so we have to learn the new way of writing and reading English. And so I'm hoping that this workshop has helped to kind of give you some idea of what are some of the issues that we face as Caribbean people who speak a dialect coming to America and trying to work our way, because we're hardworking people and, you know, want to be part of the system. Now, as Joan mentioned, and we talked about it, they're not really, it's not a new language or a different language that they're speaking. So how do we deal with these issues? You know, do we lump them into some kind of special program, or do we put them in ESL to kind of restructure the language? How can we deal with that?
Well, before we get to that, I'd just like to back up to something you said about when you talk about spelling, you know, color and color and that kind of thing. And you said, of course, you know, Caribbean students need to learn the way it's done here,
right,
because they're living here. Mm-hmm. And I think that that's an essential part of what we're doing. We're preparing students to move on to a four-year institution and onto or onto a job or both, you know.
Right.
And they need to be able to use standard American English
right.
in their writing. So subject-verb agreement is very important.
Right.
So we're not saying in doing this that well, oh, now we understand why they don't do it, so they don't have to do that.
No. But, we don't expect that.
But it's really very much like any sort of ESL issue where certain mm-hmm. languages have particular tendencies in English.
Right.
You know, for example, with Chinese speakers, they don't have a definite article, so
mm-hmm.
they have to learn to put a definite article.
Mm-hmm.
There's only one way of saying he or she.
Right.
It's the same thing, you know, you use it and it's there's not a male or a female
right.
when you say that. So they'll sometimes say she when they're clearly talking about a man. So these are, with every language has this kind of issue,
mm-hmm.
and it's really important for teachers to be aware of those issues,
right.
not to say, you don't have to learn that, but you can hear your eyes are attuned to it. You know what to help them with.
Exactly. Yes.
I think it's amazing that the was it the government or boards of ed or whatever you're speaking about in Jamaica
mm-hmm.
that validated Jamaican English in such a way over the last 25, 30 years or something.
Yeah.
I think that's amazing for one thing that they would do that. And what a strong post-colonial statement to make.
Exactly.
Think about the role of language in dominating people
exactly.
and keeping them separate or keeping them down or whatever else.
Mm-hmm.
And this is an amazing thing. So my question that comes out of this is, how do we at this school do all the things that we need to do to
mm-hmm.
get students prepared for, you know, the workplace or other college environments while still kind of honoring that uniqueness
right.
of that language?
Exactly.
You know, I think I'll answer my own question partially by saying, you know, what you were able to do last year with the, or you know, with the Caribbean
Literary
Festival
right,
is a
right.
step in that direction,
right,
where
right.
it's not only honoring for the people who come from that background, but then displaying it for all sorts of other
exactly.
folks who don't
exactly.
really maybe appreciate it or just see it as broken English and all these other
right.
pejorative ways of seeing it. But it's not. I mean, it's really it really represents this amazing triumph. I think that
yes.
it would be legitimized.
It does. It does. And you know. Was it Amy who said about that gentleman, Mr. Elliott? You know, it used to be that it wasn't even you're not supposed to. I mean, I grew up with students who were not allowed to speak that. In fact, just before I came to the U.S., I was teaching at the school, and I had written a play that I wanted the students to perform at graduation. They call it prize giving, but it's the same thing. And I approached a principal, you know, and I said, you know, can I do this play? So she said, is it written in patois, you know, which is the Jamaican dialect? I said, yeah. She said, I don't want them to, you know, really speak it because they speak it at home and they, you know, I don't want to. Okay. I said, all right, go ahead. So we put on the play, you know, and it was such a success. That night of the graduation, the principal was just rolling because it was so funny, because it was in the Jamaican dialect and there was no other way we could have done it. So she was just rolling and she really enjoyed it. So one of the things that's happening too is that it's more, the dialect has become more of an entertainment, it seems. So people will go to plays, you know, to see someone, you act out a scenario speaking the language and it's funny, but a lot of them would probably not want to speak it themselves. So it's interesting that it's now out there internationally. I have students who are Americans who want to speak it, but a lot of Jamaicans will step back from it, especially those who are now here.
Yes. If you're talking about gentlemen, it must be talking about him.
It's funny.
But going along with what you were saying, I think it also needs to be emphasized that if you're here and you want to succeed here, it's because we need to learn American English and not the right way to speak English.
Right.
Because there is no right way to speak
English.
Exactly. And there's more world Englishes than there are American speaking English. I think right now there's more people in China that speak English than in the United States.
Oh, yeah.
You know, we also need to remind them that there's many different ways of speaking English. If you want to succeed here, you want to speak American English. But I've done things in the past. It's easy in a ESL classroom to do exercises where you have students maybe write something in their language and then write it in English. And I don't know if you're working with American and students from the Caribbean, how easy that would be. But you can give a student an assignment where you say, I want you to write this in American English and then write it in Jamaican or whatever, wherever they're from, and then they can see, maybe it will help them to visualize the differences in the grammar. And again, not to say that this is the right way and that's your way, it's the wrong way, but it's just a different way, and you should be proud of that.
Right.
So.
Right. See, I think the important thing is that, you know, we have dialogue about it, and which is what we're doing right now. We're not asking for changes in terms of changing the curriculum to suit us, to suit, you know, but it's just the awareness of the fact that here is a valid dialect that, and this is a reason, you know, why a lot of Caribbeanites will use more of the dialect in their writings than they would English. Now, I don't know if that's a major issue that you're finding.
Well, my thought is that the oral language should be celebrated and it is true that in China there are lots of people speaking English that's very different from our English. It's barely comprehensible, I think, to us. So, but it is genuinely English, and I think we can respect all those different Englishes. But when it comes to writing, it's really different. And I think that the standard written English is as foreign to many of our of our native speakers, as it is to people who come from other languages and other dialects. So if we as English teachers are focusing on writing, which is I think what we're mostly doing, as English teachers, except in ESL, we don't talk that much about people speaking.
Right.
If they want to speak up in class in dialect and everybody can understand them, that's fine. But when it comes to time to write a paper, it's a different project. It's much harder to look at these black marks on this silent white page and turn them into thoughts than it is to deal with the body language and all the other stuff. I can't understand a lot of the words that Jamaican students are saying rapidly in the elevator.
Right.
But I can understand their gestures and I know sort of what they're talking about.
Exactly.
You don't have that on the page.
Yeah.
And so I think we do have to say that at this college we teach standard written English, which in America is not that different from standard written English in England or India or any other part.
Thank you.
So
I think that's worth letting people know that we honor however they want to speak.
Mm-hmm.
But writing is another story.
Yeah, exactly. Well, it's been enlightening.
Can I ask a dumb question?
Yes,
how
sure. How
do you spell patois?
Pardon?
How do you spell patois?
P-A-T-O-I-S.
It is, okay.
Well, that's a what?
French
version,
French,
but
yeah.
We spell it variously, P-A-T-W-A.
Well, that's
so,
okay.
The interesting thing is
online,
that the dialects are just dialects. They're not written, you know? People have attempted to write dictionaries, but what you find is it never works because they try to spell it or you know, write it the way it's pronounced. But again, as I mentioned, the accents vary depending on where you're from, your class, your location, rural, downtown, uptown, you know, your class level. So there's no way pretty much how to do a formal dictionary to make it an official language. There's too many variations. So, but you never know, someone might just come up. I mean, English was a dialect at one point, so, you know, you never know. Someone might come up with some kind of structure that will get us there. Well, thank you.
Thank you
for participating.